For those of you who wonder how things are going in this world of ours, this great swinging 20th century mulligatawny stew, we have a little note here from one of my favorite humor papers, the Philadelphia Evening Bulletin. Oh, they're good for about a minute. And they have on the sport page a story here about the softball team. It says, Johnny Callison has been turned to ball player's ball player. Cookie Rojas, a manager's ball player. Herman Ski is what you might call an umpire's ball player. Ski is not only a ball player, but a manager. And you could hardly classify him as a Gene Monk type. As skipper of the Christian Nine, a local softball outfit that competes in the fast Max Myers League, Ski governs his squad with a set of rules that would make most ball players blink. They are, thou shalt not smoke, thou shalt not drink, thou shalt not swear, thou shalt not argue with the umpire. Actually, explained Ski, these are not written rules. They are something our Christian ball team adheres to. We feel this is the way young Christian gentlemen should act. Please bring on a little bit soft, wonderful softball music there. Yes, indeed. And then it shows everybody on the softball team. You know how on softball teams, you ever played on a softball team and you had a thing on the back that said Larry's Bar and Grill, or it says Charlie's Garage, that kind of stuff on the back. You know, I'll have to tell you that for years on my back, I carried a sign that said Skokes SO Station. And, Skokes, S-K-O-K-S. And I remember when I used to come up once in a while in a ball game. You have no idea how it feels to come up in a ball game. And the PA announcer, you know, that the softball game says, and now batting number 7, Skokes SO Station. Is it that? I'd get up there and I'd give all my little pizzazz for the Standard Oil Corporation, and particularly old Frank Skoke, who was a heavy drinker and who spent all of his time in the Bluebird Tavern under the third stool from the left there. Well, you know what these guys have on their uniform, in case you're interested in how our life is moving on? They have quotations from John or Luke. And here's this picture on his uniform. It says John 3:16. Any of you out there got a Bible? Tell me what it is that he's selling there. It says John 3:16. And he looks pretty mad, though. Actually, his face looks like a pretty tough ball player. Oh, boy, I'll tell you, the madness in our world knows no bounds. I can't understand you, honey. Get over to the phone. That's it. Just pick up the phone and tell me what it is. Quick. There. Oh, no phone in there? All right. Then forget it. Da, 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 da. What do you mean there's no phone? There's three phones in there. Now get up and get to the phone. Don't be innocent. And, you know, that little shrinking flower. The thing I hate is shrinking flowers. Get on the phone and say what you got to say. Yeah? 9 guys called and already said Joe Penner. Well, they're all wrong. Okay, thank you. I'm sorry, it was not Joe Penner. Joe Penner is the guy who used to say, what did Joe Penner say? Let me think here. Oh, I know. Vashu there, Charlie! That's what Joe Penner used to say. And now, gang, all together, let us once again salute the deep thinkers among us. Aren't we glad we've got them? Aren't we glad? Aren't we really lucky people? You know, well, bring up, hey, that's it. Bring it up there. Bring it up right there. That's very good. Very good. All right. That's enough, Larry. I have a note here from Memphis, Tennessee. It was kind of reminded of that when I read that last one about the guys with the softball team there. You know, I'll tell you, I must confess that a couple of weeks ago, I think you were even on the show that night, Larry. A couple of weeks ago, I told a story about when I was playing on the United Brethren 9. Well, I don't know anything about the United Brethren, except that I played on their softball team. They went out and proselytized all over the place. And, you'd be surprised at how quick the conversions come once a guy's offered a starting spot in a big-time softball league. And I was playing at the UB 9, and we had this game one night against this other softball team. And they had the name of the organization they represented. And I told the story a couple of weeks ago about how we were playing this fantastic ball game. We really got hot, boy. I'll tell you, there aren't many sports where guys get as mad as they do playing softball. I'm serious. You know, when you talk about blood sports, that has to rank right next to bullfighting. And it has to rank right beside hockey. Baseball is not necessarily, I mean, real big, you know, big hardball league baseball is not as much of a blood sport as softball, primarily because the players are not as close together. I'll tell you, I got hit by a line drive one time so fast, so hard, that I didn't even know the guy had swung. And all I know is that all of a sudden I had a softball in my trap. And you know, you hit the ground and you're hopping up and you're fighting already by the time you get, you know what I mean, Larry? Any of you who have ever played big league softball, and I'm not talking about that slow pitch junk, which is greasy kid stuff. I'm talking about hard. Do you want to hear some stories about softball? You know, I used to play softball, and for those of you who are interested in real big-time softball, it is not played in the East Coast. Not the kind, no, softball really reaches its true, well, it is in certain places on the East Coast, but it is not a very common sport here along the Eastern Seaboard. For a long time, duck pins, you know, which is played up and down the Eastern Seaboard, was totally unknown in the Midwest. Duck pins, I never forget the first time I was taken bowling in Washington. I was in the Army, and somebody said, let's go bowling. We went to this bowling alley, and there's little pins down there. They were like, you know, like 3 inches high, you know, little thing. And this was not bowling to me, and they called it bowling here. Well, softball in the Midwest, it has a certain virulence, a certain hate, a certain anger that you'll only find in some of the selected passages out of Sinclair Lewis, or maybe out of the handbook of the KKK, with possibly a little dash of Father Coughlin thrown in, and, little Joe McCarthy. See, all these hate merchants have come out of the Midwest, you know, one way or another. It's pretty interesting out there. You know, wow. And you find it in its purest form in the more, I suppose you might say, least concerned areas of life. Unconscious, really, unself-conscious. And the nights of a good hot softball game, which were always in August, we were always nearing the end of our season in August. And we were jockeying for position in the league. Now, this was not little kids playing ball. It really wasn't, because they paid the ball players in this circuit. And guys would get traded. Can you imagine yourself getting traded from the Catholic team to the Holy Rollers? And, I mean, seriously, that's what would happen. And don't immediately call me up and say, I am being sacrilegious. This is what used to go on in that league. And so it was a genuine, hard-fought, tough, angry, stinky, sweaty league. And we used to play three or four nights a week, and there'd be maybe upwards of 3,000-4,000 people would show at these games. Fantastically partisan people. Because in most cases, the religious warfares that were involved went on in the stands and did not go on the field, because we were just paid minions. How many of you know how it feels to be a Hessian? You remember when you were reading the Hessian soldiers and they were mercenaries? Well, a mercenary is a funny guy. And having been a mercenary several times in my life, a mercenary is a strange guy. He often is not only cool about the side he is fighting for, but quite often will fight harder for that side merely because he is so cool about it. Now, do you follow that kind of reasoning? It is nevertheless true. And I remember when I used to read the stories about George Washington, and he's going across the Trenton or the Delaware River in the Trenton, and all these Hessians, these mercenaries were sitting over there whooping it up. And the book said that this, of course, shows that the idea of being a mercenary is a pretty bad scene, that mercenaries don't make it, and that the reason that Washington was able to get them was because they were mercenaries. You know, that was the implication. Well, I don't know about that. I really don't know whether that's true or not. As a matter of fact, I suspect that it may have been just because they had a bad, somebody was on guard duty that night and wasn't making the scene very good. That's about as simple as it could. You run into a crowd of professionals and you're in trouble. And that really is, in a sense, what a mercenary is. He's a pro. And some of the toughest fighters in the world have been mercenaries of one kind or another. And I remember when I first entered the ranks of the mercenaries, I had this buddy who was a pretty good ball player. And we were playing a lot of sandlot ball and having a great time, you know. And my entire church-going experience was maybe four times a year I would go to Sunday school like Easter, you know, I'd go to Sunday school. I would be actually sent to Sunday school. I would be propelled to Sunday school. It wasn't exactly that I would go. Christmas time, I would go a couple of times, you know, because there was always a rumor that they were going to give gifts out. And it wound up with me singing alto or something. And I was a pretty good alto singer, but not that kind. And so, all right, you got the scene. It was not that I was sacrilegious or I was an agnostic or an atheist. I was just I was kind of like an animal. I was like, you know, you can't call a collie an atheist, really. You can't call him anything else. He's just a collie walking around scratching dog, an animal. Well, all right, that was the way all of the kids I knew were just sort of walking around scratching kids. And we'd go to Sunday school once in a while and not go, or we'd, you know, that kind of scene. Well, we're out playing ball one day. I don't know whether I should be telling you this story. We're out playing. We had a real tough, hard, bitten sandlot kind of scene going, where we really had ball teams, but it was sandlot, you know. And it was organized, but disorganized. When you hear, you know, you hear the expression on TV when you'll hear somebody talk about when he was playing sandlot ball, some ball player. Well, I suppose most guys think he's playing at picnics, you know, with the fat guys versus the skinny guys. Well, as a matter of fact, sandlot ball, particularly in the Midwest, was highly organized and was very toughly fought. And so I'm playing on the sandlot ball team, which had won a couple of championships of one kind or another. And one day I'm out there fooling around third base, and my buddy who played shortstop, old George Bresch, who is 9.5 feet tall. I'll never forget to tell you. I'll have to tell you one night the time George Bresch made the triple play unassisted. And nobody was more surprised than George Bresch was. Bresch, you want to really hear what Bresch did? Well, Bresch, all right, I'll tell you the scene. There were guys on second and third. Bresch was playing short. You got the picture? Well, Bresch was a tall, lanky guy who was very good at going at sharp-hit ground balls. He could really go into the dirt after him, and he had a great range. He could go to his left and to his right. But Bresch was one of those guys who did not have particularly sharp reflexes. And so things were getting past Bresch a lot that Bresch should have, you know, should have laid a glove on. But when Bresch saw the ball, when his reflexes were working, he had a whip, boy. He could throw that ball across the infield like a shot, you know. And he used to lay a tag on a guy. You never saw anybody get tagged like Bresch used to tag him. Bresch particularly liked to get him in the left ear. And I can remember guys sliding into second, and Bresch, with that big squeak, he was 9 feet tall. See, he would get the throw from the outfield, and he would swing it around. See, the guy's trying to stretch a hit to a double. Bresch would teach him, you may be safe. It's all right being safe, but you're liable to wind up with a busted cheekbone, you know? So guys would think twice about stretching. And they would come running down to second, and Bresch would go, whop! He'd get that ball in the glove, and he would swing it with one big swing, like a guy bowling, you know. He would just go, whoo! And the guy would come sliding in, ka-dunk! And you would hear the crunch. You would hear the crunch of cheekbone meeting softball. And the umpire would holler, safe! And Bresch knew he was safe. Bresch would walk away, he'd spit. And then you would hear the sound of the entire other team running out of their dugout to pick up their fallen warrior. And Bresch had perfected this great, innocent walk. He would turn around, he'd say, what have I done? And he would run over and he'd say, is he breathing? Oh, I'm so sorry. Oh, I'm so sorry. Oh, Charlie, please, Charlie. And, of course, they'd pour water on Charlie. And, you know, Charlie's not going to get mad when the first tear-stained face he sees is Bresch's. But I played next to Bresch, and I knew that Bresch did this at least 3 times a game all through the season. And he was a great actor. So here, you got the picture of Bresch. So Bresch is standing there, and Bresch used to have Paswinski's garage on the back of his shirt. Old Al Paswinski had the big thing on the back. And by the way, he was a notorious crook. This garage was a terrible crook. In fact, he did one of the worst things I ever heard in my life. He got caught one time for stealing new carburetors off of cars when the guy would come in, you know, to get his car lined up. He would steal new carburetors off of cars and put old, used, reworked carburetors back on them. So every guy that came into to Al's garage drove out with a car a little older than when it came in. So, you know, he had a little business on the side. After all, a guy makes it here and there. So Bresch is playing short next to me one day, and it's one of those drowsy ball games, you know, where it's just, I don't know whether many of you played enough really organized ball to know that there are some ball games when everybody's with it, There are other ball games when, you know, you're just playing. And I can tell it, boy. I'll tell it when I turn on the TV or when I go out to Shea Stadium. I can tell them afternoons, if I may use a Metsian term, I can tell them afternoons when the Mets are just there, you know. They're making the scene. That's about it. And the other team is too, you know. Don't think it's just the Mets. Oh, no. I've seen some ball games out there where you have the feeling that the entire game is being played 30 feet underwater. And the water is Karo syrup. It's not real water. And they're out there just slowly swimming around, and you can see. Like one day I saw the Reds play the Mets, and the Reds were kind of stunned. You could see this because I saw two bad calls on Frank Robinson. Now, Frank Robinson is a man who has a notorious temper. In fact, Robinson hits himself sometimes. I saw Robinson clap himself right in the mouth one night out at the Polo Grounds because of something he said. He's got that kind of temper. Well, two bad calls were made on Robinson, and he just got up out of the dirt and didn't say anything and walked off. I could see him. He sort of floated to the dugout, you know, and he was a million miles away. And the whole thing, it's infectious, you know, the umpires, the other team, everybody. And the whole thing is just being played out there underwater, slowly drifting. After all, you're playing 164 ball games a year. and you know, you don't even remember. I wonder how many times you had the chance to talk to a really pro ball player. Like, you know, somebody like McMillan. He's played 18 million ball games. And 2 weeks ago, you see him make a fantastic play. You know, he dives into the dirt and comes up with the dust flying and his teeth are rattling. And he makes that long throw over to first base and he gets the guy out by an eyelash. And then the relay comes whipping back to him and he lays the tag down on this guy as the spikes are flying. And he turns around and spits in the dirt. You know, that snotty look of a ball player that's just completed a double play. And you talk to him about it 2 weeks later and you say, "Wowee, Ed, what a fantastic play against the Reds you made the other day." "What? What play?" He says, "Well, you know, remember the day you remember the day you dropped the 7-1. You remember 7-1 Reds." And you begin to get the idea he doesn't even remember that play. He could have done it 5 minutes ago and he doesn't remember it. You know, it's just all part of that long, unending tape of ball games. And then once in a while, there's a ball game when it all comes alive. And there is an instant when they come alive. Well, we were playing this ball game. It was like underwater. And everybody was playing that way. And we're drifting around out there. And I'm at third. I'm playing third. You got the same. All right. So here's Bryce right next to me. He's shortstop. And here was this little guy up at bat. There was a guy named Lefty Gurner. Lefty Gurner was that little angry type of ball player. There's always one or two guys that are soreheads. And Lefty Gurner was the sorehead. And Lefty played for this other ball team. As a matter of fact, if I can remember it now, I think it was the Methodist Reformed. you know, these names, the Methodist Reformed Nine or the Methodist Reformed All-Stars. And Lefty is walking around at the plate there, and he's looking around. And he's a left-handed hitter. And so you expect a left-handed hitter to pull. You expect it to go into right field. So immediately the third baseman's his mind sort of goes blank. And Bryce is walking around. He's looking up, and he's got the thing in the back past Winsky's garage. The crowd is sort of half asleep in their cars. All of a sudden, Lefty reaches out and tags one of Bolus's fastballs on the outside corner. He belts a shot. So it was such a line drive that I just saw a blur, you know, for a second. And when a hard-hit softball is hit, that it is hit. Well, Bryce, I don't know what Bryce was doing at that moment. I think he was stretching or something, or scratching, or he was looking at the birds, or something. But all I know is it was one of the most unexpected snags of a sharp hit ball I ever saw in my life. And there was a runner on second and a runner on third. You got the scene? Bryce, I look, I hear a pow. I hear this, you know, that sharp hit, pow, like that. And I jump immediately. I'm awake, you see, and I know that the ball is hit somewhere. And I see out of the corner of my eye, I see this, whee, a streak. And I see Bryce is about 8.5 feet up in the air. Well, Bryce snagged that ball over second base. He was about 9 feet in the air. He caught it in the webbing of his glove. It spun him around. He landed on second, therefore doubling the guy off second. Well, Bryce got up and he looked around with his teeth hanging out. You know, he's looking around real funny. And Gurner is still up there with the bat in his hand. I am still sort of half hanging. And this other guy is trying like mad to get back to third. Well, Bryce says, "Third!" He hollers. I said, "What? What? What?" Suddenly, Bryce cut over and he tagged the runner between home and third. It was a It was a triple play unassisted. Well, for one instant, the crowd hung there. It was just like that. And all of a sudden, every horn in the park, and there were 18,000 horns, that's the way they applaud a softball game in the Midwest. They blow their horns. They're automobile horns. They're all sitting in there, and they go, ooh, ooh, waga, waga, ooga, ooga. And Bryce is standing, walking around, you know, with that wise look on his face. Well, this is the kind of baseball or softball we played. Now, you got the scene. It was fast. It was hard. And it was for keeps. Well, one night, this is one of my great moments of frustration. You just can't believe what kind of frustration that happens to an athlete, a guy that's playing in this kind of, because I suspect that guys that are playing in that kind of situation where it's only glory you're getting and maybe $4 a game and your car fare, and they'll buy you some Neat's foot oil for your glove, and they'll put a little tape on your knee, providing your knee isn't broken in more than three places. After that, it's your own scene. it's that kind of ball game. And it's a highly bespiked type of thing. I mean, in other words, this is a it's very, very extremely professional in the sense that the guys play hard and play long and play for keeps. And it is incredibly physical. I often wonder about the Mets out there. I wonder why more Mets don't throw those blocks at second base. I really have wondered. Have you ever wondered that? Have you ever wondered watching them, Larry? Like, I'll never forget Don Hoke one night. You know. Remember Don Hoke? I saw Don Hoke do the little kind of gratuitous rottenness that sets off the really good ball players from the whole world of the Billy Cowans and the Hickmans. Hoke was at third base. I saw this happen in Crosley Field. Hoke was at third base. Now, Hoke played third base. I'm serious. Hoke played third base like there was absolutely no tomorrow. And, in fact, that's all he really had going for him. He was tough. He was angry and rotten. And Hoke was, he really, honestly, in many ways, he made Stanky look like a bad boy. He was all spikes. And he was sort of a high cheekbones, like he had cheekbones all over him, you know. And it was like his suit was he had a skinny suit. And it was as though it was all soiled and wet and had been dried out in the sun and was patchy color and all that. And it was gray. Even his home uniform was gray because he was always in the dirt and spitting on it and all that. So here is Hoke down at third. I'm sitting right back at third base in this game. And I don't recall the runner or the hitter, but this guy was on second base. And somebody belted a shot. And the runner comes tearing around. He's going to score from second, see? Well, it was obviously a hit. It went into right field, and Hoke comes down, of all things, I never saw the guy do this, he comes down the third baseline. Well, this runner comes running around second. He comes running around third, you know, and he runs right at me. You can see his eyes are wild, you know, he's running. The ball game is like 1-1, and I all of a sudden see Hoke, and Hoke pretends like he is running in to get the cutoff, and what he does, he throws his shoulder right in this guy's clavicle, and the guy, he flies, and he bounces twice in the coaching box, rolls over three times, and you can see his hat flying off, and Hoke turns around and looks. He's, what happened? Did I bump him? What happened? And the umpire runs over, and immediately both ball teams meet out at the pitcher's mound and start swinging interference, and Hoke say, what? What do you mean? And fist fighting and yelling, and the uniforms are torn. Well, that was a Hoke move. You just don't see Charlie Smith doing that. Now, I like Charlie Smith, but he doesn't do that kind of stuff. Well, all right. That's the kind of... You want to hear more about this side of baseball? Well, I am playing. You got the scene now. There is such a thing as the World Series of softball. Have you ever heard of it? Well, you are listening to a guy that was involved. You got that? Believe it or not. And we are playing in Soldier's Field in Chicago. It's the big time. And myself and about three other guys, late of the United Brethren All-Stars, are now playing for a well-known industrial organization that is sponsored this team. And we are playing a fantastic aggregation known as the Eastman Kodaks. Now, in my day and in my time playing this game, the Eastman Kodaks were the Yankees of softball. They had one of the greatest athletes I've ever seen in my life. They had this left-handed pitcher who was 9.5 feet tall. that if he was in any other field of sport, softball never gets much fame attached, he would be like a combination Warren Spahn and Mickey Mantle. He could hit, he could pitch. Well, we are now in the sixth inning. Shepard has not so much as even touched the ball. This guy is pitching a no-hitter. They are ahead, 1-0. It's the World Series. When all of a sudden, Shepard at bat, the guy throws one that hung. You wouldn't believe it. I couldn't believe it coming at me. It hung. Well, Shepard laid into that ball like there was no tomorrow. And you know that feeling when you know you've got a hold of it? Oh, wow. Pow! That ball goes. Well, that ball goes whistling down the third baseline, heading for the stands. Higher and higher and higher it goes. And 4 feet from the foul pole, it sharply hooked and went into the stands, a foot and a half foul. A home run. Foul. I did not touch another ball all night. And it was a no-hit, no-run victory for the Eastman Kodaks. And we went down to defeat for the first time in our tournament history. But I remember seeing that ball. No! No! I'm already halfway between second and third. No! In she goes. And the umpire says, foul ball! And that's the story of my life, friends. The story of my life.